So I will present you a design that is a configurable ring oscillator design, especially made for true random number generators. So first of all, random numbers. Where are they used? Why do we need them? So the design I will propose is mainly built to be used in cryptographic systems. There, random numbers are necessary in the various range of protocols, going from ephemeral symmetric keys to long-lasting public key pairs or parameters in challenge response protocols and so on. They are also used in other fields, like for example statistical simulations also in gambling or online gaming. Statistical simulations, the unpredictability is not that important. It's obviously important in online gaming. So how are these numbers generated? If you need high throughput and good statistical quality, then most of the time you will use a pseudo-random number generator. This is a device that uses an algorithm or some deterministic algorithm that uses some internal state update function to generate a stream of randomly looking numbers. But every time you start up this device, you want a different output from this. So therefore, you need some initial randomness, some seed value, to initialize the internal state. And this seed value is actually mostly created by a true random number generator. This is a device that will convert some fundamentally unpredictable process, like for example the decay of radioactive atoms, or some process that is just too complex to be ever accurately modeled, like electrical noise or network noise and so on. So it will convert this noise into usable binary digits. So both of these devices create randomly looking numbers. So how can we know that a certain device is creating true random numbers and not just pseudo-random numbers that come from some very complex process? The old way of testing this was just building your device, generating a lot of random data, and apply some statistical tests to this. If these tests passed, your random number generator was considered as good enough. However, true randomness is not actually a property of your bitstream, because both bitstreams, you cannot differentiate between them, but it's actually a property of the process that is generating your bits. That's why the new approach, which is also considered by the NIST standards or the German BSI standards, they require you to have a stochastic model of your device. This model is actually a mathematical proof that the process of extracting this randomness from this noise source to the eventually created bitstream is valid. This stochastic model will use some experimental parameters, like for example jitter strength or intrinsic delays. It will also be based on some assumptions made on the operating conditions. And this model enables you to optimize some design parameters to optimize the generated entropy rate. For example, you could optimize your ring oscillator length or your jitter accumulation time. And this was not, you were not able to do this by just applying statistical tests. So if you look at some true random number generators that have a valid stochastic model, specifically for FPGAs, we have a list of 6 here. And especially the last column is interesting, as it shows us the feasibility and repeatability scores of these designs. This means how hard is it to implement this architecture on an actual FPGA. A low score is very difficult and a high score is better. And immediately two designs jump out by having a very bad score, namely the current sampling one and the transition effect ring oscillator one. Both of them are very difficult to implement on real designs, and actually have the other properties are quite good, especially area. They require very low area and power consumption. So it's too bad that these designs actually are impracticable to be used on real systems, because they require such a large design effort. But why do they require such a design effort? To explain this, we have to look at the internal working. We will focus on the first one, the current sampling. So how does it work? You have two ring oscillators. One samples the other using a D flip-flop, and out of this D flip-flop comes a low-frequency beat signal. The period length of this beat signal is counted using a counter which is clocked by the first ring oscillator. And out comes a discrete random variable, which is random because of the jitter present in your two free-running ring oscillators. And what we actually want is to have a large variance in this counter output as possible, because the least significant bit of this counter can then be used to generate random data. To have a large variance at your counter output, you require these two ring oscillators to be matched, because matching these two ring oscillators will increase the period length of your beat signal. And by increasing the period length, you will increase the average value of your counter value, and so also its variance. I give you a small example here. So at the second graph shows you the output of the first ring oscillator, which is 400 megahertz. The other ring oscillator is not very well matched because there is a frequency discrepancy between the two. And you can see that the beat signal has a relatively high frequency, and also the counter output is on average very low. But if we gradually increase our first ring oscillator frequency to better match it with the second one, we will see that the beat period will become longer and the counter output will be on average higher and will have larger variance. So we can keep increasing it, but we have to keep in mind that only one bit can be extracted every period of your beat signal. And so your throughput will decrease by matching this first ring oscillator by the second one. So it will be a trade-off between generated entropy and throughput. By increasing the matching, eventually you will have perfect matching between the two ring oscillators, and your beat signal will stop oscillating because you're always sampling the same signal. So your throughput will be zero. This can be explained in a stochastic model. Here we can see that the variance of your counter output is proportional to the expected value of your counter output, and your expected value is inversely proportional to the period length offset, which is given by the delta. If you plot these equations, on the horizontal axis we have our period discrepancy, so to the right is better matching. This is related to your counter average output at the top. If you see the entropy will gradually increase until it saturates for certain counter values. And if we take the entropy throughput product, or the entropy generation rate, we see that it has an optimum because of the loss in throughput for better matching. The standards tell us that we need a minimal entropy of 0.91 bits per bit, so we have to be in this top green area, which is correspond to every counter value at the right of 74 for this particular FPGA. So what we want is a configuration that has a frequency period offset close to this border here, but slightly to the right to be okay with the standards. But the question is now, how can we achieve such a period offset? Because once two ring oscillators are implemented on a physical device, their frequency is fixed. So the old way of trying to accomplish this was to just implement two ring oscillators and then go through every possible position on the FPGA until you find by luck one that is suited for use. This is of course very slow, very labor intensive, and has to be repeated for every device separately. So what we want to do is to remove this manual intervention and create a bitstream eventually that will work on every device separately. To accommodate this, we use this architecture. So this is actually a network of multiplexers, and a controller can activate every individual multiplexer. By doing this, you will create a unique path to this network. You could change this path until you find the delay you will need. So every column is actually a single stage in your ring oscillator. By using two of these architectures, we were able to automatically select a frequency that we want and obtain the entropy we need. So the overall TRNG architecture is given here. So we have our original TRNG, but now the ring oscillators are configurable. A controller will monitor your counter output and feedback a configuration signal to comply with the standard. The controller algorithm is quite simple. So you just go, you just monitor some counter outputs. Every time you find one that is within the required range given by the stochastic model, you increment another counter. If you have seen enough samples, you will check your counter. And if you have seen enough good samples, you will keep it this configuration. Otherwise, you will go to the next one. And you will go sequentially through all configurations until you find one that is good enough. So now we have to experimentally verify our proposed architecture. So is it able to achieve the frequencies? Is it able to achieve a wide range of frequencies to be able to obtain the required matching? Can we place it on every position in the FPGA and it will still work? Does it require relative routing constraints? Because in the past, TRNG design, for TRNG designs, relative routing was more the rule than the exception, because to increase matching, you would require symmetrical routing. So we would check if we still need that. Also, can this architecture easily be ported to other FPGAs of different manufacturers? And the last question we asked ourselves was, how many stages do we actually need to make this work? Because more stages will give us more options to configure it, but will also increase area. So the first question, can it produce a wide range of frequencies? Yes, it can. As you can see, the range goes from 140 to 240 megahertz, which gives you a range of 100 megahertz. And if you look at the average counter output, we see that we get enough samples that lie in this green region, which it was determined by the stochastic model. So this was a success. Then we looked, we implemented this design on 25 different placements. And each single placement was able to achieve a counter output also in the green zone. So this proved that this design was actually independent from placement. We also implemented it without any placement constraints, and also placement was entirely led to the FPGA synthesis tool. Again, we achieved the similar results as with placement, and we had counter values that were in the required range. Then we also checked if it could also work on other FPGA devices from another manufacturer and how much effort it took to port it to the other architecture. That was actually very easy because there were no placement constraints. And again, we obtained, as you could see here, enough values in the suitable zone. In our last experiment, we checked how many stages we needed. So one stage only gives 16 configurations, which is clearly not enough to reach a counter value in the range we needed. Two stages was in theory enough, but we choose to be more robust and go for three stages, which gave us almost 5% of the configurations that were actually valid. So on average, the controller has to go through 20 different configurations until it finds one that is suited for use. So to conclude, we also generated some random bits with it. So at the top, you can see the average counter value that was minimally required by the stochastic model. This is more for the Smart Fusion 2, because measurements showed that Smart Fusion 2 had a reduced jitter strength than Spartan 6. The obtained average counter values were very close to the one that were theoretically required, but slightly higher to be on the safe side. Throughput on Spartan 6 was higher because of the increased jitter strength, and minimal entropy was above the theoretical one required by the standards. which is 0.91. We also made a comparison with other work. So our work is the first one that doesn't need manual placement and routing or specific primitives. So it's easily portable. If you compare it to the other core sampling designs at the top, we see that we have one of the largest throughput because we were able to better optimize this frequency discrepancy. We have to give something in area because of the controller and the added number of stages, but it has to be noted that our design, due to the controller, has a built-in self-test. So in case something goes wrong or something is attacking the TRNG, the controller will notice and can notify the end user of this random data. So this is required by the standards to make a fair comparison. This also has to be added to the other designs. So this was my talk. Thank you for listening.